the aisles pulling people out to dance for them. So, this is my tribute.
It's nothing short of a miracle. Uncle Kevin's niece. I mean, I called him Uncle, so. I'm a mariachi singer, but I won't sing that today, unless you want. So I'm gonna sing a song and in English, and you know what?
Good afternoon, friends and family. Most of you know me as Kevin Stephanie's son, Justin. We gather here today to celebrate the life of my father, Kevin James Cobo. To assist us with this is our family pastor, Dr. Kevin Cook, who will be officiating our service. He's been one of our pastors since the 80s. Please welcome Dr. Kevin Cook.
Thank you. Justin, let's just stand and just pray. Lord, we thank you. We just give you thanks in all things because you deserve our thanksgiving always. We thank you that you are a God of love and strength and comfort, and that you are a God who can do the next thing. That you are God who can bring us above and help us to rise above. We thank you. We thank you for this family. We thank you for Kevin's life and the influence of his life in so many people. We thank you for all that you're currently doing in the lives of his family and extended family. Father, we just give you glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Justin mentioned, I had the wonderful privilege of knowing Kevin and his family for some time. So I feel it a privilege and great pleasure to have known him for decades. It's been really really good. And, you know, every time that I came into contact with Kevin, he was always happy.
Yeah.
Always happy. And, you know, I was thinking about this earlier today. I'm not sure how people come into heaven. You know, I don't know if it's a bus, if it's a door, I don't know what it is. Whatever it is, he is going to be there greeting them. That I know for sure. He's already got a spot probably now. He was just a man of tremendous joy. And he was a man who was an eternal optimist. Glass was always half full, never half empty. I'm not going to be long. I want to share three scriptures with you that I felt like the Lord gave me specifically for Christine, James, Justin, and Crystal, but I believe for all of us, if we can hear them in the right context. The first scripture, and I think all of these probably will resonate with you. But the first one that I want to share with you is Romans 8:28. I'm just going to read through each one. But this is the first one, Romans 8:28. It says, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them." Let me read that again. "And we know that God causes all things, everything, to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose for them." I believe this, one of the reasons the scripture is in the Bible, is because everything doesn't work out the way we hope. Be great if it did, huh? Yeah, we could probably market it and sell it. But everything doesn't work out the way we hope. And when it doesn't work out, God has a safety net for us. His safety net is the scripture. And he says, and no matter what happens, everything that happens, the good, the bad, the ugly, I'm going to make sure that I weave it and braid it all together so that you come out smelling like roses. That's pretty cool. You know, loss, death, it's full of sorrow, pain, sadness, but God somehow has the ability to cause. That's what the scripture says, that he causes, which means he has a direct influence on making it all work for our good. Now, it doesn't happen automatically. There are two criteria. The first one is that we love him, and the second one is our life is full of his purpose. And when we meet those two criteria, God says, don't worry, I'll make it work for your good. I'll make it work for your good. The second scripture is Isaiah chapter 6. Starting verse 1. It says, "In the year that King Uzziah death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne and exalted, and the train of his robe was filling the temple. Seraphim, angels, were standing above him, each having six wings, with two each covered his face, and with two each covered his feet, and with two each flew. And one called out to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of armies. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the threshold trembled in the voice of him who called out, while the temple was filling with smoke, then I said, woe to me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of the armies. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal in his hand, which he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth, and with it said, behold, this has touched your lips, and your guilt is taken away, and atonement made for your sin. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me. And he said, go. King Uzziah was a great king. He reigned for 52 years. And there's only two other kings, Solomon and Jehoshaphat, who brought great prosperity more than Uzziah did in Judah and Israel. He was a fantastic king. So when he died, Israel was all out of sorts. Judah was all out of sorts. And Isaiah was a big, bewildered by it as well. But in this death, Isaiah is saying, I saw something. I saw the Lord. King Uzziah died, but when King Uzziah died, I saw God. And I saw him in all his glory. And his glory filled the temple, filled the heavens. And there were these angels around, and they were singing and saying, holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty. I saw it. And then I recognized that I was a person who was in need of salvation. I saw all of my sin and all of my stuff. Not only my stuff, I saw the stuff of all of my people. But God, in all of his mercy, sent an angel to touch me with his tongues that came from the altar, the coal, that my sin was taken away. And when my sin was taken away, I heard a voice say, whom shall we send? Who will go for us? And I said, send me. I believe death opens up a pathway to see God in a way that we've never seen him before, to receive from him in a way that we've never received from him before. It offers us an opportunity to know God more deeply than we knew him before. It offers us an opportunity to be circumspect about our own stuff. Right? We recognize that we are mortal, and it allows us to be able to look at ourselves in the mirror and say, you know, I got some stuff. I got to deal with myself. But God, in all of his mercy, forgives us because he loves us. And I believe the precursor to God forgiving us of our stuff, I believe the precursor to seeing God in a greater way, in a deeper way, I believe the precursor to the call of God on each one of our lives, death. See, it's interesting, in the kingdom of God, death represents something completely different than it does in the world. In the kingdom of God, God uses death as a launching pad for more of what he wants, more of what he wants to do, so that there's a greater relationship that you can have with him. While it's sad, because there's loss, there's comfort in knowing, boy, God's got something good. for you. Here's the last scripture I'll share with you. And this is Joshua. First one. And it speaks to what I'm saying. It says, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I am giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on land I have given you. From the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, and the Euphrates River in the east, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live. For I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you, nor will I abandon you. Here's a wonderful thing. God says to Joshua, Moses, my servant, he's dead. Therefore, that word therefore is sort of like an effect of. You can say it like this. Since Moses is dead, let's listen to this part. The time has come for you. Since Moses is dead, the time has come for you. I find it odd, interesting, mysterious in some way that God has reserved some aspects of blessings for our lives in death. Because we think of death as being so bad, so sorrowful, so horrible, and it is. But even God is bigger than that. Even God is higher than that. And he's saying to Joshua, Joshua, my servant Moses is dead. Now is your time. And this is the prophetic word that I feel like the Lord has given me, Christine, James, and Justin, and Crystal. Kevin is dead, and now it's your time. Arise and go forth. That there are things that God has reserved for each one of you for this season. For this season. It couldn't have happened in a previous season. He's reserved it for this season. He says nothing will be able to stand against you. Absolutely nothing. Just wanted to share those three scriptures with the family, but with all of us, as a way to help us come to a place of not just being able to deal with the hurt, the sorrow, and the pain, but actually to look on the horizon. See, sometimes we're afraid to look toward the future, because the future oftentimes is just so vague and ominous. But this gives us an opportunity to actually look to the future. My servant Kevin is dead, but now it's your time. Now it's we just thank you. We thank you for all that you are. We thank you for all that you do. And we don't always understand, God, what you're doing, how you're doing it, when you're doing it. We don't always understand, but faith is greater than our understanding. We just look to you, and we hold on tightly to you. And we say, we're riding with you, God. We're riding with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming. Did you guys see the prayer cards?
Yes.
It's a letter from heaven. What rhymes with heaven? The man of the hour. Yeah. So it was interesting that we were picking out the prayer cards. It was interesting because it said a letter from heaven and it sounded real peaceful. And we all look back and we say, how obedient am I to God? Well, this is one thing that we had to laugh together because he's been telling me for months to write Kevin a letter. So when I had a choice of cards to pick, this one just popped out. And I heard in my consciousness, my Holy Spirit said, you didn't write that letter. It's time to write the letter. And I said, but Lord, I was supposed to write it a long time ago and read it to him. He said, you're going to read it to him. So here it is, my letter. And it's really short. Because Kevin did everything fast. Kevin was a party. Actually, I can relate to Kevin's word today. I had a vision when this started, the demise started. And I'll just share it with you because I thought it was beautiful. God showed me when Kevin passes, his chest is going to pop open, confetti's going to come out like a piñata, and he'll be free. But I was there for the last breath, and there was silence, just silence. So that was the peace that I asked all of you to pray for. I put messages out, I put prayers out, just pray for peace. And I thought, wow, that's peace. So anyway, here's the letter. It says, my dearest Kevin, many months ago, God instructed me to write you a letter. Oh, I thought it was kind of silly until he told me things to say in this letter. We put our 45 years together, as I had failed to recognize them while toiling through them. You see, the first time I laid eyes on you, I was 13 years old, and you walked through my parents' dining room, and I thought that you looked like a rock star. I'm so glad we stayed friends and could start dating when I was 16. I never met anyone like you, so I admit that you scared me a bit, but you fascinated me even more. I saw you as this young man that had a job, transportation, an apartment, so when you attended church with Mom and I thought, wow, he even knows how to score brownie points. So I just wanted to thank you for falling in love with me and making me feel so special way back in the 70s. I feel that what makes a good man fit for God's glory is a man of good character, one that sows into others so that they can be vindicated in life. It's one of my favorite stories that most of these people probably have heard of your kids. This is my favorite story. It's about the time that you were on a motorcycle, you heard about a motorcycle enthusiast that ended up in a wheelchair and he was stuck in his apartment. He gathered supplies to build a ramp. You fastened them to your motorcycle, you rode over there and you built them around. I can't even imagine how surprised this guy was
to hear an arm ring at his door. And then there's like, we teach others to ride unicycles, police ride alongs, block watch, president of our neighborhood group, greeter at the church door, and the best praise for the town ring. You took your family on hikes and sand dunes, but I still don't understand how we got up or down in Arizona, California, or Utah. Looking back, we had a blast. I wasn't ready to say goodbye, but when someone you love becomes a memory becomes a treasure. God told me sometimes less is more, and he was calling me home. While God has you in his arms, I'll hold you in my heart forever. And people can come up and share if they like.
Thanks, Andrew. I wanted to share a quick little joke with my dad from growing up. When I was younger, he said, there are three things that happen to you as you get older. First, you lose your memory, and then you forget the other two things. My dad was a man of many qualities. He was smart, funny, kind, and caring. One of the earliest childhood memories I have of him was how motivational he was. And if I ever doubted myself as a child, he would always tell me, never say you can't. And that's something that always stuck with me. When I was 9 years old, I learned how to ride my first ATV, and he bought just for me. And I remember when he was younger, he discovered the sand dunes in California, and that place created some of the greatest memories for him, as well as the rest of my family. We went on so many weekend and holiday trips, and it's just unforgettable, the experiences we had. And I remember when I first started learning how to drive, and how unique that experience was, learning a lot from him. First time I drove a vehicle, it was my parents' GMC Jimny, which was the greatest EV at the time. And I remember it was off-road, and he was in the passenger seat, and we were up in Cinder Lake, which is up north, and we actually drove on the highway out of the camping area, and by the time we got back to camp, I remember him saying that you did very well for your first time, and it's just something one of the greatest memories I have with him. And I know a lot of people grow up without a mother or a father or sometimes both. However, I feel loved, blessed, and fortunate that was not the case with my family. My dad was always around. He was very family-oriented. He was a very social person. Even if he didn't know you that well, if he liked you, he wanted to socialize with you and get to know you. And that was one of his finest qualities. My dad had a great sense of humor. I remember he always used to impersonate certain cartoon characters or characters from movies, and anybody who knows me was like doing those silly voices too. And I just think that's something I feel like I inherited from him. He always had such a good balance in his life. He was a hard sport guy, and he always made time to be a family man, to spend time with my siblings, my mom. Spend time with my Uncle Mark, whether he's building sand rails or going to the sand dunes, my Uncle Bruce with his planes. He was always working on projects with planes, with flying planes, and it was good for him to spend time with them and their projects. And I remember with my Uncle Mike, when we would go to Payson, he'd see him when he could, so he just made time for everybody, and I just love that about him. And one of the greatest things I loved about my dad is that he was a man of God. I grew up a Christian believer because of my parents. And being a Christian all my life is the greatest gift and blessing to me. And I thank my parents for that. And my dad was one of the greatest followers of God on earth, as I know he still is now in heaven. someone makes it to heaven, it creates a very special place for whoever makes it there. And we all know that he loved going to the sand dunes and riding dirt bikes and camping. And I think what God did for him was when he arrived, he created a special kind of place to have for him with sand dunes, where it wasn't just like a dry desert like we have on here on Earth. It was more glorified by him because he knew that's what that was, and he would still love that forever. And with that being said, I do want to thank you all for coming. God bless you all.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm really excited to see the whole room actually filled up. I started to get worried that everyone seemed to be a little late. For once, I was finally early or something. So I didn't really prepare anything, because to be honest, I kind of said goodbye to my dad a long time ago. And over the last probably few months at least, I kind of just felt like he was mostly just suffering rather than living. So I didn't really take it as hard now as I did when it finally hit me all the way back in 2018 that my dad was gone in 2018. That was the feeling I got. So what I did was pretty much exactly what Mom did, but I just did it 3 years ago. I wrote a letter. I wrote it to my dad. I actually sent it to him on Facebook. So I just pulled it up now. He's never seen it, obviously. But I just pulled it up now. I'm going to go ahead and read it. Please forgive me if I cry like a baby, because this was a really emotional moment for me in my life when I wrote this. I said, "It makes me sad on a level that I refuse to express, to know that the man who made me who I am is in perfect health and cannot message me back. I see your comments and posts in my Facebook memories every week, and I always react to them and respond as if you'll one day read them and reply." This part's gonna be hard. "Mom thinks you're gonna get better somehow, and it breaks my heart. I know miracles happen, and I know God is the ultimate deciding factor. I just can't push myself to be that optimistic, because I won't deal with it very well when it doesn't happen. I'll have broken conversations with you every day until you can no longer hear. I will never forget how lucky I am to have had you in my life. I know I'm going to end up having dementia one day too, and I can just pray that I can prolong it as long as I can. I want to make sure I have the time to provide the kind of life for my kids that you did for me and Justin and Crystal. I was scared for about a year that I was going to get the call that you had died in a motorcycle accident. I had this fear because I just had this fear that you knew what was coming and you would prevent it in your own way by doing what you love. You told me when I was a teenager that you would rather die than be a burden to your family. Your passion since before I was born was motorcycles. You made me love them at an early age. You always made me laugh when you didn't want to drive cars because motorcycles are better. Anytime we went in a car, you would make 5 right turns to avoid a left. Your hatred for left turns made me laugh because you never had a problem making a left on the motorcycle. I'll never forget our last ride. At 67th Avenue, you popped a wheelie in first gear, and then second gear, and then third gear, and then you realized how fast you were going, and you slowed down to the speed limit. You're such a talented rider, but soon after you pulled up to that light at 75th Avenue, you could not figure out how to tell me that you were low on fuel. You pointed at your gauges, and then pointed forward, and I understood. We were on the way to bike night, so we stopped at Quick Trip on 91st Ave. At bike night, you always let out your best. You had conversations with complete strangers, and it was sometimes hard to even tell there was anything wrong with you. This was a very hard time for me now because I want one last ride with you.
Mom is going to uninsure your motorcycle this month.
Watching you go downhill will be one of the hardest things I ever have to do. Mom is right to uninsure your motorcycles now, but it's still very hard. The sweater could go on for hours, Dad. You'll never have even read it, but I love you, and you'll always be the most important man who's ever involved in my life. I did get that last ride. I snapped a picture of him from behind him, which was really hard to do on a motorcycle. But I knew it was going to be the last time I would see him in front of me stop at a red light. And honestly, probably 90% of the bonding time we have ever had was always motorcycles. And there's not a single thing about my childhood that I would change. He did everything his way, and it made me who I am today. And I could never thank God enough for bringing him to us. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Amen.
Amen.
Foundation in Christ, because not only did he dance in worship, but I always saw him with his Bible open to the page. He was writing in his Bible. He was nodding his head. I could just see how much he loved the Lord. And just like Justin said, that really helped me stick with my faith. My daddy on earth is so a lover of my daddy in heaven. And I just, that love he had for God, he had the same love for us kids. And that's unfathomable, the love of a parent for a child. Miss him, but you know, he had this way with words. He would always mix up some letters and make people giggle. So, in a way, happy birthday, Dad.
I didn't say some things about my father. I'm a child that most people don't know about. But I like to keep to myself, and there was a time when me and James were younger, and James had a place, but I didn't really have a place to live. So I went to my dad, and I was like, Dad, I'm going to be getting an apartment here, so let's see. But my credit's not too good. He said, don't worry, son, everything will work out. And I ended up getting that apartment, and he helped me learn different things about finances and all types of things that I didn't know anything about. And any time I needed him, I knew exactly where to find him, in the garage working on motorcycles. And he would stop what he's doing to talk to me and teach me things that I needed to know. And I'm going to miss that big game and talk to him. And the last time I saw him, I kissed him on his forehead and he knew it was me.
He did.
And he knew it was me. I was like so happy that he didn't hear my voice. He wanted to get out of bed. He wanted to get to me. I was like, it's okay, I'm here. And I'm going to miss him forever. But I'll see him again.
Amen. Love you, brother.
Love you too.
Hello guys, my name is Brandon. I'm actually, if you want to say a friend, another child, or another mother, whatever I want to call myself, but I've been Justin's friend for over, 20 years? We've been friends for a long time. Consider yourself like brothers. I pretty much consider Justin's family, not just him, but his whole family like my family. I actually went through this years ago with my family, so I lost my dad too. It's not the easiest thing to go through. I remember Justin called me, I think, a few days before his passing, and he told me that pretty much asked her advice, like, what do you do in this situation? And I was like, just pretty much what I just did. So I told him what you gotta do. You know, because we can't clap our hands and make everything good. As Pastor Cook said, we wish we could make everything joyful, but it doesn't work that way. So what we can do is do what makes your dad happy, because technically your dad is not gone. He's gone, he's not on this earth anymore, but he's in a better place in heaven. He's probably riding a motorcycle. Like what Justin said, it's probably not even desert, it's probably like crystals and gold up there. Who knows? He's probably having a blast up there right now. And he's with his relatives and he's with his family now. So I told him that just be strong and do whatever you do to make them happy, and he's still here. He's just in heaven now. So, and also wanted to share about that. When I used to go to Justin's house all the time, he kind of reminded me of my dad. So, family oriented, cared about his family, made sure his family was taken care of. The only thing I do wish that my dad would have done is have more gatherings or go out, but we didn't really get that far. You see, I lost him when I was 13. So one of the big reasons why I love to go at Justin's house was because it was so family. And I remember, I wish I could have had that when I was getting older, but I didn't get a chance to. But from what I've noticed about Kevin is that he was just like my dad. He was a hardworking man, great man, cared about his family, went to work every day, loved cars, loved motorcycles. As a matter of fact, my first motorcycle ride was actually with him. So I wish I would have got a picture of that. But they're gonna forget that. That was actually pretty fun. I thought I was gonna fall down. It's like when you slow down, it's like you're fine. So you're okay. You're not gonna fall down, but I'm gonna fall. Okay, you're not gonna fall. Just relax. So anyway, but he just had that. You know, my adjustment was like, yeah, he had. I trust him. Okay, here. I was like, well, I'm just gonna ride right here and just say hi to everybody. But you know, he was a good man. I think there's not really good men like that anymore. So he's gonna be, I actually thank God, I feel lucky that I had to get to meet him. A great family, and they're still a great family, nothing's changed. I'm still gonna be here. And a great man, hard, like I said, hard worker, loving, family of God. We'll see him again. This is just goodbye for now. We'll see him again in heaven, in a better place. He's probably, when I see him, he's probably going to need a full motorcycle this time. Can you rest in peace, Kevin? We love you.
Mentally and emotionally doesn't have the capacity to be here, but he really wanted to be. And he said, please know, Kevin was my very best friend during the most enjoyable times of my life. He was the man who introduced me to the writing of the dunes as well as the cinders. And I remember well the camp of the family who enjoyed each other, fire sticks, candles, fireworks, flies in certain places were always on the agenda. One must never forget the night rides, the rubber glove pizza, the occasional broken leg, not to mention having to dig nearly to China to get our motor home on his stuff.
Good times.
They were the best. And I thank you. They really just meant so much, much to us as a family.
Yeah.
Being part of your family and going to France with you. I guess on my part, one of the best things that I remember about Kevin is he actually let me write his back.
Yeah.
And I actually jumped. I lived the air and he told me I was right. We love him and we love you.
Hi everyone, my name is John Cook, and I moved here, I believe in 91, from Minnesota, and the only person that I knew in church was my brother, Kevin Cook. I had just met Johnny and Kathy, I had just met Jerry and Judy, I had just met Christine and Kevin. And one of the most profound things that would happen to me, every Sunday that I would come, Kevin would walk up to me smiling and hug me and then shake his tambourine and dance around me. Every Sunday, he would hug me and shake his tambourine around me, no matter what I was going through. And I had a lot of dark issues in my life. And he always made me see that there's hope in a tambourine. But here's the thing. Physical death is permanent. But the Bible teaches me that to be absent of the body is to be in the presence of God.
Yes.
And so even though physical death is permanent, God is eternal. And how do you define eternity? It just doesn't ever stop. Ever, ever, ever. Never, never, never does eternity stop. And so, today, he did leave a miracle. Stand up, sir. Stand up, James. Stand up, Justin. Stand up, Chris. Here is the miracle, right here, that God left through Kevin Cobo. So God does work miracles. Just, you have to look at it in a different way. Because Kevin Cobo lives through all his children. God bless you all. God God, I love Christine because she always had a heart. She had the heart just like Kevin, and they were equals. You know, I'm looking at the pictures, and he's a biker and a rock star. And every picture that I see, Christine is his movie star. So God bless you all, and I love you.
Y'all are invited to worship at Homestead to break some bread. Gino will be addressed. Anybody that doesn't, stop us.